Build Right is the educational division of Sparkbox, working to inspire and empower a web built right. For more information about Build Right or to have one of our workshops at your company or event, check out buildright.io. If you'd like to have Sparkbox help you make your web better, visit csparkbox.com. You're watching Dan Mall's Build Right Maker Series on Design Workflow from October 30th of 2014. The Build Right Maker Series is brought to you by the folks at Sparkbox and these generous sponsors. DataYard, performance-driven cloud hosting for kick-ass websites and applications. Campaign Monitor, a simple and elegant email marketing software for business. Shopify, a hosted, theme-based e-commerce platform. Harvest, simple time tracking, professional invoicing, powerful reporting software. Additional thanks to our secondary and giveaway sponsors for their help in making the Build Right Maker Series possible.
Hi, everybody. So we're going to have a pretty casual time today. I have a talk that I'm going to do this morning, but it's not so much of a talk. So if you ever have any questions or anything like that, you don't have to wait until the end. Just raise your hand. We'll stop. We'll talk. We'll have conversations. You know, all of those things will be good. So feel free to do that. Oh, we're starting a little early here. Well, apparently, Stephanie had reached her ceiling. She was a musical prodigy. She learned piano at age 4, she wrote a piano ballad at 13, and she performed in clubs when she was 14. She got into Tisch at NYU at 17, but despite all that talent, she hadn't found a way to make it big. Here's a beautiful song written and performed by Stephanie 10 years ago, when she was just 19 years old. Have a listen.
One look and I'm done. One glance from your eyes and I'm captivated. The taste of your skin, the warmth of your hungry lips has me so taken.
Anybody recognize this song? Nobody. Okay. I won't ruin it. We'll come back to this. You guys are just in time for the sing-along. Ready? I think as an industry, we're subject to three things. We talk about ourselves in these ways, right? We talk about our titles, we talk about our tools, and we talk about our output. We say things like, I'm a designer, I'm a developer, I'm a content strategist, I'm an information architect. And we use a lot of words like this. We generally sort ourselves into buckets, right? It's cleaner that way. It's an easy way to tell people what you do. We also talk about our tools, right? So if I'm a designer, I might use things like Photoshop or Sketch. If I'm a developer, I might use Sublime Text or CodePen. By the way, Sparkbox just launched a CodePen redesign today. If you haven't seen that, you should check that out. It's really good. Content strategists use Word, Excel, things like that. Information architects use tools like OmniGraffle. So if you walk by somebody's desk and she's using OmniGraffle, there's a high likelihood that she's an information architect. But that's a little bit weird to kind of make judgments like that. It's like a mild form of racism. You know, it's like OmniGraphalism, something like that. I don't know. We talk about our output too, right? So designers make comps. Developers write code, content strategists write documents, and information architects organize information. And again, it's cleaner that way, it's a little bit more simple, but our deliverables, all of these things are a bit outdated for the squishy, gidgy, icky, responsive world that we live in, where people are accessing the things that we make on different devices, on TV screens, on billboards, on things in their hands and in their pockets. It's a bit limiting. And when I think about all the projects that I worked on, and maybe when you think about the projects that you work on, it's easy to kind of silo what job you do. But if you think about the projects that haven't gone so well, they usually fall apart in the gaps between the job descriptions, right? Like, it's not like the designers didn't do what the designer's supposed to do, or the developers didn't do what the developer's supposed to do, but maybe there was some conversation that they should have had that just didn't happen, or there was some misunderstanding between those two roles that made the project not as optimal as it should have been. So a few years ago, I started my own design practice called Super Friendly, and I was determined to find a new set of tools and a new set of output to better suit my clients, the people that I hire, and the customers that my clients work for. So I came up with a couple of goals for things that I wanted to try and be able to do. The first goal was, for anything I made, I wanted to have the highest fidelity in the shortest amount of time. So as an example, I could work on a set of comps for 3 weeks, but it takes 3 weeks. So what could I do that was the same level of fidelity as a comp, but how could I do that in 3 days or maybe even 3 hours? Was that possible? Is that something that I could actually find? The second goal was to be able to remove abstractions wherever possible. I found that in the work that I do, clients had the hardest time with things that were abstract. So as an example, a wireframe is an abstraction of a website. And I've had a lot of instances where I show a client a wireframe and they go, yeah, that looks good. And then we get into design or we get into build and they go, oh, no, this is not good. And you're like, well, you said that this was good. And they're like, oh, I just didn't understand it. So, and I don't blame clients for that. It's just an abstraction. And so sometimes you don't understand the abstraction until it becomes real. And then you realize what it actually takes. So I wanted to, in my deliverables, in my tools and outputs, kind of remove those abstractions wherever I could. And I think the last thing was that I thought all deliverables should come with conversations. Too often I would like send over some comps or send over a deck of something and just be like, that thing speaks for itself. I'll just write a Basecamp post or a short email and then I'll get the feedback that I needed. And what I found was that actually wasn't working very well. So instead, I said, you know what? I'm not gonna make any deliverable try to stand on its own. Every deliverable that I make has to come with a phone call or a Skype call or a Google Hangout or something where I can talk through the thing that I'm making, even if I think it's self-explanatory. Even if I think the comp does well enough, I'm still gonna talk through it. And so for me, I started thinking about these things as frameworks instead of processes. As an industry, we talk a lot about design process and development process and work process. And I think that's a good word, but I think it's a little bit disingenuous to the thing that we're actually trying to do. And for me, I think the word framework sums it up a little bit better than process. So here's what I mean by that. How many of you have seen this? Newton's cradle, Newton's pendulum. This is a process. It is a repeatable system. It's designed for efficiency. It's designed for optimization, but it's not designed for innovation. Right? Nothing surprising happens here. It's not like one day you're looking at this and it just does something different. You're like, wow, how did that happen? It's designed to do exactly what it's supposed to do. That's a process. This, on the other hand, is a framework. Right? This is a football field or a soccer field, depending on the part of the world that you come from. Every soccer game or every football game is the same length. Out of bounds are always in the same place. The goals are always in the same place. The rules are always the same. You know, that doesn't change. But within that, within those constraints, every game is different. That's where star players emerge. That's where trick plays are drawn up. That's what makes this game one of the most dynamic and interesting things to watch in the world. That's why it has so many fans worldwide, is because within that framework, people are allowed to innovate. People are allowed to do things differently as a way to support this framework. So I think the way that we look at design and the way that we look at development and the things that we do should be a little bit more like this, you know, where we should have the constraints and understand the constraints, even if they're the same every time, but be able to explore within that, be able to do things differently in order to get better outcomes, higher scores, improved players, improved efficiency, like all of those kinds of things within here. So my goal was, how could I find a new framework for designers? So I want to share with you some of the things that I found over the last couple of years. This is ever evolving, but I want to show you kind of where I've landed so far or where I am right now. The framework that I've got has 4 parts. And I'll talk through those 4 parts today. And again, if you have any questions about that, feel free to stop and we can talk about this. I think the first part of this framework is that designers need to be planning more. Right? Now, if you think about the typical skill set for a designer, designers are typically in front of Photoshop. They're typically in front of Sketch. They're typically in front of some GUI that makes them edit graphics. And so when I say designers need to plan more, that might be a little bit out of the ordinary for what you're thinking about. Now, I use the word designers not just to mean graphic designers or UI designers or interaction designers, but to mean anybody that is making things for clients or for bosses or for colleagues or for products. So when I talk about designers, that's kind of what I mean by that. My favorite definition of design comes from my friend Jared Spool. He says, design is the rendering of intent. And so anybody that is doing some work where you render intent, I think, is part designer. Content strategists are part designers. Creative directors are part designers. Developers are part designers if you're rendering intent. Engineers are part designers. So this is what I mean by the word designers here. I think all of us need to be able to do a better job of planning. So what does that look like? Well, I think one of the things that designers could be doing more of is interviewing. right? We usually leave that to a researcher. I'll let the researcher do, let the anthropologist do that. But I think that's something that really could influence our work. I did a project with a publishing company, and they make a magazine, they make a print magazine that's really a great magazine. I think it's beautiful, I think it has great editorial direction. Their site left a lot to be desired, so they hired us to redesign this site. And one of the things that we did before we did anything, before we even kicked off the project, was we talked to 30 people who read the magazine. Some of them read the magazine exclusively and never visited the site. Some of them did sort of half and half. And a couple of them only used the website and didn't really read the magazine very often. And just from doing that, we found out a lot of really different things, a lot of interesting things that influenced the way that we actually worked on the project. So as an example, these five screens are screens from a PDF. It's about a 20-page PDF that we brought to the kickoff meeting and just discussed with them. And we call this the Themes and Insights deck. And we just wrote one insight or one theme at the top of the page and one paragraph about that thing, and then supported it with three or four quotes from the people that we talked to. Now, this magazine has a primarily female readership, so a lot of these use she as the pronoun or her as the object here. So one of the things that we found from the female readership was a lot of people said when they read the magazine, they have an emotional context. Like a lot of them actually used that phrase, which we thought was interesting. And they said, this is my emotional context when I'm reading. And so one of the things that we were asking about and inquiring about was, do people have the same emotional context when they use the website? Should they? Are they supposed to? Another thing that we found was, if you look in the top right, again, another phrase that most of the people we talked to said was, I'm obsessed with Pinterest. And almost, I think maybe 25 of the 30 people that we talked to would browse Pinterest while reading the magazine. So could we design an experience that took Pinterest in mind that sort of helped that transaction be a little bit more fluid? Maybe the most important thing that we saw was in the bottom left corner, she sees commerce as a service. So I think 30 of 30 people that we talked to said, I would love if this magazine recommended products to me. I would love if they said, here's the shampoo that you should buy. Here's the cleaning products you should have in your house. Here are the accessories that you should have in your car. Here are the apps that you need to download. Now that is a massive advertising opportunity. And this magazine, they had never done anything like that or anything close to that because they thought, well, we don't want to be spamming our reader with all of these things, all of these advertisements. But the reader is begging for it. You know, the reader is saying, I trust the magazine. I trust the editorial. I want you to recommend things to me because I trust that. And so they're leaving potentially millions of dollars on the table just by not doing that thing. And so we centered most of the project around this because a lot of the goals for the project were how to increase their revenue. So we said, what are the product opportunities here and what can we investigate here? And it became a really great project. Now the thing that I want to focus on here is we did that just by talking to 30 people for an hour each. So it's 30 hours of time before the project start, and it was very informal. We didn't have a usability testing script. We didn't have anything. We just said, we'd love to know how you think about the magazine, how you think about this brand, and what things you'd like to see from it. Very informal conversations that led to product opportunities, led to revenue opportunities. And I think that's something that anybody can do. Now certainly if you have a researcher on your team that is professional and does that for a living, sure, you can get more mileage for that. But even guerrilla style, even any one of us getting on the phone and saying, hey, just tell me for 30 minutes or tell me for 15 minutes about what you think about this brand, what you think about this service, what you think about this product, I think could glean a lot of themes and a lot of insights. Another thing that I like to do when I'm working is I like to write manifestos. I like to do that before I do anything. And sometimes it's not called a manifesto. Sometimes you might have these on your projects. They might be called creative briefs or strategic briefs or communications briefs, things like that. How many people write those or have seen those or used those on projects? Okay, so a handful. So I'll tell you what mine often include. For me, before I design anything, I like to write. I like to write out my problems, even if it's just for myself. It's sort of a journal, but it's sort of like a brief to myself. Like, what am I actually doing on this project? Oftentimes, I will write down maybe the three most important things on the project on post-it notes, and I'll just stick them on my computer screen as I'm working. And then the next project, I'll do the same thing. And it just kind of helps me to keep focused and keep centered on what I'm doing. And then when I'm in a design project and I'm having trouble, maybe I come across something that I can't figure out or I'm having trouble thinking about, I just write it out. Instead of trying to comp it out or code it or prototype it, sometimes writing is just as valuable as a prototype, at least for me. So some of the writing tools that I use, how many people have seen this one? Do you know what this is? Anybody? This is a tool called OmWriter. One of the things I love about this tool is that it forces you to not be distracted. Like, it forces you to focus on this thing. You cannot minimize the screen. You can't shrink it to whatever size you want. By default, it is full screen. I have dual monitors at home, and it just shuts off my dual monitor. So it's just this. You can pick a background for it. So there's like some subtle textures, or you could pick the snowscape. This is my favorite one. And there's a little bit of ambient music that comes with it that you can turn on and off if you want to. And it's just like a nice, focused writing environment. You can't switch to something else. You can't be like, oh, let me put this next to my browser. You can't do any of that stuff. And I love using this tool. Another tool that I use is this one. It's called Notational Velocity. This is my note-taking tool. And I use a fork called NVAlt because it supports Markdown, so I can write in Markdown. And I just write about everything. So this is an example. I went to a restaurant, and I had this was the tasting menu. And I was like really inspired by this tasting menu, so I decided to write down what was on the tasting menu. I do the same thing with projects. I do the same thing with notes or things that I'm thinking or things that I want to write about or things that I want to do, trips that I want to take. It syncs to your phone nicely. It's really lightweight. And so this is one of my favorite writing tools that I have open all the time.
Dan, what's that called?
This one?
Yeah.
Notational Velocity. Yep, and this is a fork called NVAlt.
Can we do a quick reset on the connection?
Yeah.
Just want to make sure live shift. You can keep talking, that's great.
I'm happy to.
Yeah.
So NVAlt is a good one. Notational Velocity is a good one. It syncs to your phone through an app called Simple Note. Maybe some of you have used Simple Note before. It's what I like about it mostly is that it's so lightweight. So sometimes when I use other tools, it kind of takes a while to boot up, kind of takes a while to load everything in. Notational Velocity, there's really nothing there. So it's really, really quick. It syncs quickly. So that's one of the things that I like about it most. How many of you use different writing tools? What do you use?
I'm using SimpleNote.
SimpleNote, okay, cool. Yeah?
Use Byword.
Byword, what's that? Nice.
Defaults to full screen, but this is nice. It syncs through iCloud, so I can use it on my phone, on my iPad, on my Mac, so I can pick up where I left off whenever I feel like I want to write something.
Gotcha. Cool. Anybody else? Writing tools?
I'm sure it's a cliche, but Evernote.
Evernote, absolutely. It seems like you've seen some slides in my deck, because I will get to that one in a minute. Anything else? Any other writing tools? Cool. So funny you should mention Evernote. Well, look at that. Do you want to finish this talk? Evernote is a great tool for this. It helps you collect your thoughts. It supports a whole host of other things like videos and images and all sorts of things that you could put into it that other lightweight tools don't support. If you haven't used Evernote, it's at least worth a try. And here's a way that you could use it for writing manifestos. Here's a video of my friend Aaron Walter. He's a director of UX at MailChimp. And he talks about how they use Evernote to inform strategy and how they use it to write creative briefs, strategic briefs, manifestos, and things like that.
We started using Evernote Business very early on, where collecting a lot of feedback from customers, I decided to start forwarding it over to Evernote. I did a quick search, and within a few seconds, I had about 45 pieces of feedback. And then I'd stage that up and start to write a strategy plan. So that was a light bulb moment for me, where I just felt like that's the way it should work.
So what should a manifesto contain? What should be in a manifesto? We talked about the tools that you maybe might use to write a manifesto. That's not revolutionary. I mean, you could use all the tools that you're used to. You can use Microsoft Word or Pages or whatever. Anything that lets you write words, technically, you can use a code editor to write a manifesto. But what should be in it? Well, I think the main thing that a manifesto should contain is creative direction. Now, what is creative direction? I think the web is suffering from a lack of creative direction. I think without strong creative direction, everything kind of feels vanilla. And that's the web that we see today, right? Like, how many people have seen that link floated around that said, this is every website out there that's got the image at the top, and it's got the text over the image, and the three boxes below, right? There's a reason that that exists, and that exists for a good reason, which is it makes it quick, it makes it easy to make websites, it makes it easy to figure out things responsively. So it is a functional reason, but it's vanilla. From a creative direction standpoint, there's not a lot of perspective in there. So flat design is not a point of view, it's not a perspective, it's not creative direction. CSS3 transitions, that's not creative direction. What does creative direction look like? Creative direction is really just saying, what is the point of view that you have on this app, on this service, on this product? What is the perspective that you have? So in a manifesto, you should say, this is the perspective that we're going to use to approach this project, to approach this site, to approach this publication. And you should say what you're going to do. Here's what we're going to do, and here's how we're going to do it. And by virtue of that, more importantly, it should say what you're not going to do. So let's look at an example of what that actually looks like. What I'm going to do, let's play a little game. I'm going to show you an architecture of a website, the main navigation. And I want you to tell me what site it is. Does that make sense? Everybody with me? Okay, here we go. What site is this?
Expedia.
Expedia, good guess. Any other guesses?
A city website.
A city website, okay, good guess. What else?
AAA,
yeah, totally could be. Anything else? Disney World, yeah. Right, so you're sort of getting the point. It could be any of those sites, right? It's fine. It's a good architecture for any of those sites. But by being a good architecture for every site, it's kind of a good architecture for no site. So let's take a look at what good creative direction, what good perspective, what good point of view can do to affect even the main navigation of a site. Okay, so same deal. I'm going to show you a navigation of a site. You tell me what site it is. Here we go. What site is this? That's right, it's for Dayton, Ohio. No other site could have that as the main navigation, right? This couldn't be Disney World site, it couldn't be AAA site, it couldn't be, you know, it couldn't be any of those things. It is specifically for the city of Dayton, because it has a perspective, it has a point of view. Like, this is how creative direction influences everything. My friend Brad Frost wrote an article about responsive navigations, but he had this really great gem in here. He said, navigation doesn't just provide wayfinding for users, but also it communicates to users what features and services the experience provides. And here's the gem. Navigation is branding. Right? And branding is all about creative direction, too. It's all about perspective. It's all about what sets this thing, this entity, this site, this product, apart from every other site, product, entity out there. So, what would a manifesto have to contain to get to an architecture like that? Maybe the manifesto says, Dayton is awesome. We're pioneers, true OGs. Let's celebrate exactly what makes us unique, our humble roots and entrepreneurial spirit. Right? So that's a bit aggressive. It's a bit, you know, maybe it's a bit slanted there. But notice how much of a point of view it has. Right? That leads you to a design that can only be Dayton's, a development pattern, a development approach that can only be Dayton's, a architecture that can only be Dayton's, something that is very ownable by the brand of that city, of that organization. If you're more interested in manifestos and creative briefs and things like that, Jared Spool wrote a really great article on UIE called The Magical Short-Form Creative Brief. It is a fantastic article. I go back to it every time I'm writing a manifesto just to remind me of what it needs to contain. It's a really good one. So if we take a step back, and we look at the tools and the output that I'm talking about. This is very non-traditional for what designers should be doing, right? Like, I'm talking about using tools like OhmWriter and Notational Velocity and Evernote to make things like manifestos and to do interviews. These are normally not under the purview of a designer, right? Designers should be comping. But I think these are the kinds of things that start to contribute to what designers should be doing in this modern, responsive, multi-device world in order to get the best output, in order to better work with your colleagues, in order to better serve your clients and your bosses. You know, these are the kinds of things that we should be doing more and more of. All right, everybody with me so far? Nobody fell asleep yet? That's good. Okay, so the second thing in this framework, the second piece of this, is that I think designers need to be inventorying more. So let's look at a couple of different types of inventory. An interface inventory is a great type of inventory to do. Brad Frost wrote an article on his site and where he took a screenshot of all the buttons on his bank's website. This is from one bank's website. Like, look at this is crazy. From one bank. You know, you would think that this was like compiled from all the different banks out there. No, this is just one site. Now, it's not because the designers there were incompetent. It's because sometimes the project gets away from you, right? Sometimes when you're in the trees, you can't see the forest. And that's where this comes from. So one recommendation I have is sometime in the middle of your project, do an interface inventory, because it'll keep you on track. One of my good friends, Jason Santa Maria, he's one of the best designers I've met ever, and I think one of the best designers out there working for the web. He did an interface inventory when he was designing an app called Editorially. And he's a great designer, but he still noticed that there was a lot of discrepancy between the stuff that he was designing. So if you look at his interface inventory, there's so many buttons, so many different styles, so many slight tweaks on things that didn't really have any purpose. It was just because as he was designing screen to screen, you know, he would try to design the stuff for the screen. And then as he took a step back, it was hard to see that until he did this. So once he did this, he was able to consolidate all of those things into something that looked a little bit more like this. Now look at how much more cohesive this is. Look at how much more consolidated this is. This allowed them to do a lot more things. It allowed him to have a design language that he could use that was concise and that was meaningful and intentional. And it allowed their development team to build a style guide that looked like this. and be able to use those ingredients elsewhere. We'll come back to that concept in a little bit. But the idea there is by consolidating your design language, you make it easier for your team to work together, and you also make it easy for your users because you're reducing the cognitive load on the site, you know, where they're having to parse through what each thing means. What does this color mean? And what about a button that's rounded instead of square? Does that mean something different? You know, these are things that are subconsciously going through people's minds as they're browsing through a site. So if you could simplify that for them, you can potentially make your app, make your site a little bit more meaningful. I worked on a redesign of O'Reilly's site, and this is the beta site that was launched a couple months ago. And when I was doing this project, I did an interface inventory in the middle of it. Now, I'm a pretty good designer, I think. And so when I did my interface inventory, I was really surprised at the number of variation that I had here. So this is, imagine on the right, this is a mobile screen, right? This is a screen on a phone. And I inventoried all of the things, all of the ways that I was showing an article. So I was showing an article as sometimes title only, sometimes title with image, sometimes with title with image and topic, sometimes title with image and kicker, sometimes title with image and kicker and deck, sometimes just all these different ways to show an article. There ended up being, I think, 22 different ways to show an article just on this site. And so what I did was, after I did this inventory, I showed it to the rest of the team, and together we said, well, what are the things that we could actually use? And we came up with five. Three definites and two maybes. So we decided we can get away with a title and a topic and a deck, and a title and a topic and a byline and a deck, and a title with a topic and a byline and a deck, and then a couple of maybes there as well. You know, so sometimes we would use a title with a topic and a byline, other times we would use a title with a type and a byline. And that's all we needed for the site, these five ways as opposed to 22 ways. So I think whenever you're in the middle of a project, just take a step back, do a little bit of an inventory for yourself. It'll help your colleagues, and it'll help your users. Maybe one of my favorite types of inventories is to make performance budgets. I did some work with an organization called Radio Free Europe, and we did sort of an open redesign. If you haven't heard of Radio Free Europe, most people in the US haven't. They're clearly larger in Europe. They're an organization that reports the news in countries where free press is banned or where a government is not fully established. What they do is so important that people have been hanged or jailed for accessing content. And so we've heard stories about people illegally crossing country lines and state lines just to get a 3G connection, just so they can access the site. And that's illegal in those countries. They serve hundreds of millions of page views a month. They serve 150 different sites over 60 different countries. What they're doing is really smart in terms of progressive enhancement and performance and content management and all that stuff. But for this project, performance was really paramount. We did this project in the open, so if you want to read about it, we posted stuff on the blog as often as we could. This is Kim; she's our design director, and she wrote about the project. This is Tim; he was my developer on the project. He wrote about connection speeds and how we were going to start designing for that. One of their designers, Carl, wrote about the double-sized responsive image technique. So we tried to address everything from strategy to development approaches to design, you know, as often as we could. And like I said, for them, performance was literally a matter of life or death. So we started the project knowing that, and performance became the anchor or the pivot point that we based every other decision against. So for that project, we started to use new tools. Webpage test was a tool that I hadn't used ever before until starting this project. How many of you have used webpage test before? Okay, a couple. How many of you have not? All right, so it looks like we're about half and half. If you haven't used it, it's great. It's a free tool. It's webpagetest.com, I think, or .org, excuse me. And you can plug in your URL there or the URL that you're trying to test. You click Start Test, and you get a results page that looks like this. And it tells you, these are the results for my personal site, and it tells you how well your site's doing. It tells you what your first byte time is. It tells you what your start render time is. It tells you what your document complete time, fully loaded time, speed index. There's timeline views. There's all sorts of great stuff in here. I just recommend you poke around and see what you can do. They also give you recommendations on what to fix. So you see, I got an F for first byte time. If I click on that F, it says, well, maybe you should try this, or maybe you should try, you know, doing this on your server, or try tuning it this way. So it's a really great site. It's educational. It's free. It's awesome. So we used this a lot, and we basically made a performance budget. That was one of the first things we did on the project. We kicked off with them. The day after the kickoff, we made a performance budget. It was the first deliverable. And so this is how we made a performance budget. We made a simple spreadsheet with a couple of rows and a couple of columns, and we took their site. This is their mobile site. We used their mobile site because it was faster than their desktop site, so it would be good to benchmark against. And we were making the site responsive, so if we were making the site responsive, we wanted to make sure that it was at least faster than their mobile site. So we just ran this through web page test, and we recorded all the numbers. 4.193 seconds for start render, 5.65 for visually complete. 7.9 for fully loaded. Then we took all of their competitors. Now they're a new site, they don't really have competitors, but there were other organizations that they wanted to be like. You know, they admired NPR, they admired The Guardian, they admired Al Jazeera and the BBC, so we just inventoried their sites too. And then what we did was we flagged the fastest sites in each column. And for this one, actually the fastest site was theirs. So we could have just said, cool, well, your site is faster than everybody else's. As long as we don't break that, we can kind of stick here. But when we were working on this project, Tim, who is a developer, he found a really great stat out there that said people perceive tasks as faster or slower when there's at least a 20% time difference. So that gave us a little bit of a benchmark for what we could shoot for. We could have stopped here, but instead what we did was we said, well, what's 20% shaved off of each of those numbers? So for start render, instead of 4.193 seconds, people that are used to browsing the site and it's rendering in that amount of time, if when we launch the redesign, it starts rendering in 3.35 seconds, then the people would notice the difference. They would be like, oh, this site is actually faster now that we've redesigned. So those were the numbers that we were shooting for. Now, this still isn't very actionable, right? Because, you know, how many times, for any of you that have done performance budgets on your project or talked about performance, how many times does a conversation go like this? We want our site to be really fast. Great, how fast do you want it to be? Really fast. Okay, we'll start designing. Right, like it's not actionable. There are no metrics there. And even this is like, okay, well you could say, how fast? Okay, 3.35 seconds for start render. Great, we'll start designing. Right, still doesn't give you anything actionable. So there are more steps that you need to do in a performance budget. All of those speeds at web page test, or at least for the one that we were measuring, 3G, is measured in kilobits. Right, so the 3G speed from web page test, the mobile speed is 768 kilobits per second. But we don't measure things, and we don't measure resource in terms of kilobits, right? That's a speed. We measure it in terms of kilobytes. So we have to do a little bit of a conversion. Now, it's going to get pretty mathy in here for a couple of minutes. If you need to stand up or get some air, that'll be fine. We all support you. There are 8 bits in 1 byte. So if we do a little bit of simple math, 768 kilobits per second divided by 8 bits per byte, that gets us to a speed of 96 kilobytes. Right, we want this in kilobytes, and you'll see why in just a minute. So if we do some conversion, we take that 3.35 start render time, and we multiply it by 96 kilobytes per second, we get a kilobyte weight of 321.98 seconds. Now what that means is, if we have 321.98 kilobytes on the page, it will start rendering in 3.35 seconds. If we don't, if there's more than that, we can't hit that target time. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay. So that basic equation will let us figure out how many kilobytes we need on a page. That we could design against. We did the same thing with the other times, the visually complete target and the fully loaded target, to get us to how many kilobytes we need on that page. So let's take that first one and let's look at what we could do with that as designers and developers. If you measure that across the 5 general resources that typically load on a web page, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, images, and web fonts, you can distribute it. And so this shows you the average sizes of these files, HTML, CSS, and JavaScript, from SitePoint. I think these are 2014 averages. The average HTML file weighs 60 kilobytes. The average CSS file weighs 58 kilobytes. And the average JavaScript file weighs 295 kilobytes. If we do the math, we're already over budget. Right? There's no way we can hit our 3.35 second start render time. We're already over budget. We're 91K over budget. So we need to make up 91K from somewhere. So maybe what we do is we say to our developer, how do we get that JavaScript number down? How do we get that CSS number down? How do we get that HTML number down? Now you treat this just like a financial budget, right? Like I'm married, my wife and I have a budget. When I'm like, I would like to spend money on clothes or on sneakers because I'm a sneaker fan. She's like, well, you're over budget on your sneaker budget. I'm like, okay, can I take that away from our gas bill this month? And she's like, no. Right? You get the idea. So you horse trade here. And so you try to find those 91 kilobytes somewhere. So maybe your developer says, actually, that 295 kilobyte weight includes jQuery. And I've been meaning to try a project without jQuery, just vanilla JavaScript. So maybe that number comes down, and we can get that to 29K. Well, if we get that to 29K, we have 175 kilobytes left over. So what can we do with that? Maybe we can distribute that evenly between images and web fonts. And that tells you I've got, you know, 87K for web fonts, 87K for images. Maybe I can get about 4 images on the page. Maybe I can use 6 web fonts on a page and still make my 3.35 start render time. Now look at what this gives us. As a designer, before I start designing anything, as an information architect, as a content strategist, as a whatever, I know that I have 4 images and 6 web fonts to work with. before I start anything, how many times have you worked on a project where you design the whole thing, the full thing, the amazing thing, it's everything you hoped and dreamed, and then you take it to the developer and you're like, make this work in 1 second. And the developer's like, no way, you gotta strip all the images out and we can only have one web font. Right? That makes a developer the gatekeeper, and developers don't like being in that role, but it makes them have to do that. If before you start any work, you know what the constraints are, that's incredibly liberating for a designer. Designers do all of their best work under constraints. This gives you the constraint to work with. Now you can figure out a solution within this before you design the thing that's amazing, and then you have to scale that back. Everybody with me so far? All right, so if you look at these requirements, you're like 4 images and 6 web fonts, and we could still get the page to load in under 3 seconds. You're like, well, maybe I don't even need 6 web fonts, right? So maybe you could do a little bit more trading. Maybe you can say, well, I'll move those down to 4 web fonts, right? I can get away with making a really good design with 4, and that gives me more images. Maybe that lets your CEO get that image carousel on the homepage that's made of six images, and still get that render time. You know now, way before on day one of the project, way before you've designed anything. Yeah, I can make that carousel work. I can make that homepage design work because I know what I can do with it. I know I can do that in 3.35 seconds. Or I know I can't do that. What are we going to be able to trade? Can we take an image away from there? Can we get that HTML weight down? Can we get that JavaScript file down? Could we take away a couple of web fonts? So this gives you the ability to kind of trade, to have good discussions with your colleagues, with your bosses, with your clients. I often present performance budgets to clients. We talk about that. We talk about things that will affect performance if that's a major thing on the project. And this gives you the ability to do that. Any questions on that? All right, we're gonna move. Another kind of inventorying that I love to do is a visual inventory. So I have a confession to make. Starting a design scares the crap out of me. Like, when I look at this, like, there's my Photoshop document, I'm like, I don't know what to do here. I start with way more questions than answers, right? And clients hire us, your boss trusts you, your colleagues are looking to you to have the answers. But when you have more questions than answers, you're like, I don't even know how I'm gonna do my job. So what I've started to do is I've started to write down those questions, right? So one of the questions might be, well, is showing the app on a shiny laptop the best way to sell it? Like, is that the best way to do software as a service site? Can the brand pull off a minimalist design approach? Maybe that's something that the client has asked for. Should the copy be more playful than it is now? Right, these are all questions I had before I started design. And so when I start now, I generally tend to start in Keynote instead of starting in Photoshop or Sketch or Illustrator. And this is what I do. I take all those questions, I start a blank Keynote document, and I'm able to fill this much more quickly than I am able to fill a Photoshop screen. So what I do is I have a question about playfulness, as an example. I'll find a playful site, which is easy to do. I take a screenshot of the site, and I paste it into Keynote, and I do this like cool crop thing where I'm a designer, and I crop some of the edges. And then I write a little sentence or question next to it. How playful and whimsical should the new site be? For example, the GoGo Squeeze site is full of smiles and kitschy illustrations that make you grin as you explore the site. And then a link, so that they can click on that link and actually go see the site for themselves. And the last thing I do, if you keep your eye on the GoGo Squeeze logo there, I just Photoshop in the client's logo. Right, so this is like CNN comes to you and they're like, we want to be playful and whimsical. And you're like, okay, sure. So you could spend 2 weeks or 3 weeks doing a playful CNN comp, or you could spend 30 seconds to find a site like that and just Photoshop their logo in. Right, so remember the first goal in the framework, highest fidelity, shortest amount of time. I could spend the time doing the comp, and that would be very high fidelity, or I could have a similar fidelity that leads to the same conversation. Right, and then I could talk to them about this. So rather than keeping those questions to myself, I just figure I'll just have a conversation with the client about all the questions that I have. So I make a deck that's maybe 30 or 40 of these slides, which takes an hour or two to make, and then I send it to them and I say, hey, let's get on a call and let's talk about all these things. And so when I have questions like this, like I have questions about the color, should it be flat, should there be a little color, should it be monochromatic, should it be highly saturated? I have questions about concepts, like should it be software as a lifestyle, should we show the app, should it be case study driven? I have questions about tone, playful, should it be playful, should it be professional, should it be something else? I can easily rule some of those things out in that conversation on the first day of the project, not 3 weeks in when I do 3 concepts for them and then they throw away 2 of them, right? They basically throw away 2 weeks worth of work. Instead, I could do it in 30 minutes. And I can get a sense of, okay, they're really into highly saturated, they're monochromatic, maybe we do a case study driven concept, maybe we do something that's a little bit more professional than playful, you know, and now it gives me a starting point for these comps.
Dan?
Yes?
Do you, when you're creating, spending that 1 or 2 hours and picking different sites and making that, are you choosing those based on some feedback you've got from them in the first place, that some of them initially saying, we think we might want this?
Yeah.
Are you going to look for some of that?
Yeah, it's a great question. So the question is, like, when we're making this list, where does that list come from? Like, does it come from client feedback? Does it come from stuff that I'm thinking? I think it's all of those things. So in the sales process, I'm trying to find these things and inventory these things for myself. I make a little bit of a list for it. Sometimes I ask them in the first meeting in our kickoff, like, what are you guys really interested in? What sites inspire you? What are some themes that are big for you, for your organization? What does your CEO love? Like, what's your CEO's favorite site? You know, so I'm trying to capture those things, and then that becomes the basis for the visual inventory. Sometimes when I don't have the basis, I'll use my best judgment. Like, that's part of why they hired me to do something is, I'm like, you know what, I think they're probably going for playful, and I may not know that, so I'll make it a hypothesis, and I'll say, okay, let's try this. Like, should it be playful? We think you're going for playful, and they will very quickly tell you, no, we're not. Or they'll say, like, yeah, kinda, like, we want to explore that more. So I think at this stage, a guess is fine because you only spent 30 minutes doing it. When you get into doing a couple of weeks on a comp or into a build or something like that, it's much more risky. It's much, much more expensive to make those changes. So highest fidelity in the shortest amount of time here, it's I think more comfortable to take a couple of guesses. If you're not wrong, you know, it's just a screenshot that you're like, okay, cool, I'm glad we put that in there because now we know. Great question.
Do you find multiple iterations of this, especially on who you're talking to, mm-hmm. and they feed up and you have to come down?
So what I've, my experience with this, so the question is, do we do multiple iterations of this stuff? And I think that's a tough question. So far, what I've done is up to 2 iterations of this. I'm sorry, up to 2 rounds of this. So showing one, they'll have some feedback on it, and then I'll show another. I've tried to do 3 once, and on that 3rd round, they got too itchy. Like, ugh, stop showing us screenshots of other websites. Like, just make a thing for us. You know, so I want to stop short of them getting really itchy about it. And so I think like 2 is good. Generally, I think most times I do 1 of these. Like, let me get a sense of what these things are, and then now that I have a sense, I can go and do something else. I can do wireframes or a prototype or a comp or a mood board or something like that.
Do you feel like you're bracketing
them
into space with these?
Yes. So the question is, do I feel like I'm bracketing them in the space with this, into space with these? Absolutely. And I need to do that because otherwise I'm doing 11 comps. And I don't want to do 11 comps. I want to do 1. Great question. Anything else? These are all great questions. All right. I wrote about visual inventories. If you want to read more about it, you can check them out on my site. There's a template there for a Keynote and PowerPoint template. I mean, it's pretty easy to make on your own. But if you want to start with something, you're welcome to download those templates there. So as we look at inventorying, same deal here. Like, tools, output, very different than what a traditional designer is used to. I'm talking about using Keynote. I haven't talked about Photoshop and Sketch yet. Right? I'm talking about using web page test as a design tool. You know, writing performance budgets as a design deliverable. Those are very different, but I think those are very important for ways that designers should be working nowadays. The 3rd piece in the framework, I think designers should sketch more. Certainly pencil and paper, but I'm not exactly talking about that. I'm talking about different ways to sketch, maybe higher fidelity ways to sketch. We often think of sketching as low fidelity, and I think that's great. I think it's important to have low fidelity things. But I also think there's a way to sketch in a high fidelity way that gets to different parts of a project. So I want to show you what a couple of those look like. One of my favorite high fidelity sketches is an element collage. I call it an element collage. I did a project with an organization called Reading is Fundamental a couple of years ago. And if you don't, does anybody know Reading is Fundamental? Yeah, a few people. Does anybody not know Reading is Fundamental? Okay. So Reading is Fundamental, they have a pretty simple mission. They want to give books to kids who have never had books. That's it. They want to raise a lot of money, spend all that money on buying books, and then give all those books away to kids. What they found is that there is a correlation between areas of the country and neighborhoods that have low literacy, and in those neighborhoods, they have high crime, or they have a lot of welfare, or they have low graduation rates, or they have low income. And what they found is just by raising literacy in a given area, they can actually eliminate some of those statistics. Welfare goes down, crime goes down, income rises. So they're able to do that just by giving books to kids. So they hired me and my team to do a redesign for them. And when we kicked off with them, I could only help but take a ton of notes. So this is my sketchbook. I didn't even sketch anything that day. I basically just wrote everything. I just tried to capture everything that they said. And they kept saying these things over and over. There were these things that they just kept bringing up. They kept saying the word electric. Whenever we talked about brand, they kept talking about their brand as electric, which is such a powerful word. They kept talking about things like shape, harp, book, bubble, like as elements of that brand. They talked about visual book lists. They talked about pages themed in books. They talked about turn the page for step two. They kept saying these phrases. And these are phrases that they champion in their organization. They talk about these when they talk about fundraising. They talk about these when they're marketing. They use these phrases a lot. And so it kept, like, those things kept sticking in my mind. When I went home the next day, I just opened Photoshop, and I opened a 2,000 by 2,000 document, and I just started to create things. Now, we weren't scheduled to do any design work yet. We were gonna do content strategy work with them, we're gonna help refine their architecture. Those are the first things we were gonna do. But I just couldn't help but I needed to get these things out of my head. And it was just for me, I wasn't planning on sharing these. So I started to illustrate, like, what does turn the page for step two look like in a UI? Well, maybe it's a button, maybe it's a donate button that just kind of looks static, but when you roll over it, you get this kind of flip book thing. You know, and then the next iteration of that was, well, maybe it's a donate button where you suggest certain donation amounts, because what they were finding was people were donating like $5, $7, you know, which they appreciate, but they wanted to get donations more in the line of like $20 and $50. And one of the things I know about working retail is that customers are much more likely to do something if you suggest it to them than if they come up with on their own, right? If you're like somebody's in a fitting room and you're like, hey, you should try this shirt on, they're more likely to buy that shirt than if they had tried to get it off the rack themselves. So what if we suggested maybe a $25 donation, maybe a $50 donation, maybe you could learn more about our donations. Like, maybe that was a thing. And again, I don't know how this fits with the architecture yet, because we haven't defined it, we haven't created it, but it was just a way for me to illustrate some of these phrases. You know, visual book list. What if kids could browse the site with their parents and just find these collection of books that you could get as a bundle? Like, and maybe you browse them like a physical skeuomorphic bookshelf. What about pages themed in books? What if we could get parents to donate by playing on the nostalgia of, you know, when they read Harry Potter, or when they read, you know, Goldilocks and the Three Bears when they were kids? You know, and I wrote this copy, and I had fun. I'm not a copywriter, but, you know, I love writing copy that says give a gift that's just right for Goldilocks and the Three Bears. I mean, that was fun for me to do. Now, I didn't think that was going to be the final copy, but it was fun for me to do. It was an exercise for me. And what I found was I really enjoyed turning powerful phrases into visual hooks. And actually, once I did this, I was like, they would love if we turned their phrases into visual hooks. They would love it because it's a way to say, we listen to you, and quite literally, we turn the thing that's important to you into a user interface. We turned it into something that people can interact with. They're no longer abstract concepts. They're no longer things that you just talk about. We could actually turn those into something that people can click on and move and hover over and do those things with. So the way I decided to present it to them was, I created a new Photoshop document, I drew guides down the middle, so I've got this 960 pixel width column, and I just started stacking these things right down the center. And I was thinking, I'll just make a long web page of all these things. And it's not meant to be a web page, it's meant to just be a collection of things. It's meant to be a collage of elements. I said, well, okay, this is an element collage. So our team looked at what does a hero thing look like that was maybe masked with the shape of their logo. You know, we looked at typography studies, like what would the type combinations be on the site. We looked at the donation screen. Like, I don't even know if we are going to do any of this stuff yet, but what could a donation screen look like? What would a playful, electric donation screen actually be, that uses illustrations that let you see if you donated $50, we would get to donate 20 books, you know, things like that. We looked at book reviews. Like, again, we didn't know if book reviews were going to be on the site, but we said, well, what if we pulled content in from Amazon and then we added little pieces like, you know, Owl Moon, all this stuff comes from Amazon, but Reading is Fundamental has donated Owl Moon 4,600 times. Like, we could add metadata that they have into this. We looked at iconography and data visualization and things like that were just fun and relevant to their brand, something that they could own, something that no other site could actually have. And so we tried to capture the style of Reading is Fundamental in these elements. Now, they're not a web page yet. And we got really great feedback on this. Basically, what they said to us is they said, obviously, this isn't a website, but I see how it could be one. And I think that's a really powerful piece of feedback that a client can give you. And I think that's what we look for when we design responsive sites, right? Like, how many times do we design the iPhone view, and then the iPad view, and then the desktop view, and then the CEO says, well, I have a 27-inch monitor. Like, what would it look like on my monitor? And so you design the 27-inch monitor comp, and then, well, what does it look like on the iPad landscape? Then you have to design that comp. Like, there's just too many devices to support, too many form factors to support to be able to do that. So at some point, we have to ask our clients to imagine. We have to say, okay, here's what the style looks like. Imagine if we assembled it differently on a small device than if we assembled it differently on a large device. And when the client says to you, when your boss says to you, when a colleague says to you, I could see how this works now. I get it. You don't have to make that for me. I get how this is going to work. I think that's the point of any design deliverable, any prototype, anything that leads up to the final website or the final app or the final product, right, is an approximation. It is an abstraction. So as close to high fidelity as you can get on that, and the better you can get them to say, yeah, I can imagine that working. I can see how those things come together, I think is a great piece of feedback. The next project that I did after that was for TechCrunch, which is a news and technology blog. And it's largely written. And they publish, I think, something from 80 to 100 articles a day. So the first place that we started in the element collage was quickly on color palette and then really, really in-depth into typography and type combinations. And so for this one, I mean, I try to buy as many typefaces as I can, but I don't own all the typefaces in the world. And so I needed a tool that would let me experiment with typeface combinations and type exploration that weren't just the stuff that I had. So we started to use this tool called Typecast. How many people have used Typecast before? It's a great tool if you haven't used it. It's excellent. Monotype actually, I think, purchased it recently and then made it free. So it's a free tool where you could experiment with basically a ton of typefaces that come from different web services. So I think it integrates Linotype and Adobe and Typekit and MyFonts and you know, I may be wrong about those specific foundries, but they integrate a ton of web services into here where you can just play with type in the browser. So here's an example of some of the exploration we did in Typecast for the TechCrunch site. And so I would set some type here, and I'd set some type in Photoshop, and I'd do some mixing and matching, and I'd take something from here and screenshot it and put in Photoshop and tweak it and push and pull it around and just kind of go back and forth. And we were able to hone in on a type combination really quickly in here that lets you publish shareable URLs, so we would just kind of look at stuff in browser. And it also helped us to eliminate the problem of, well, things render differently in Sketch or in Photoshop or Illustrator than they render on the web, and maybe rendering is going to be a big factor here because that was important to the client. So setting type on the web and being able to kind of use it and manipulate it and work with it real time helped us to move through the type combinations really, really quickly. Other things we explored in the element collage and other things that I learned in this second go-around for element collages, it helps when you show states of things. It makes it look less like a web page. So if you could say, okay, here's how a thing would animate or here's how a thing would open when you interact with it, it kind of helps it to be more of a documentation diagram than a comp itself. We looked at things like share clusters and what breaking news would actually look like that felt like their brand, felt like their identity. We looked at, well, what does a headline view of articles look like? What does a very irreverent, gigantic tag cloud look like for their site? Because that was part of their brand too. If you don't know TechCrunch, they are a very irreverent brand. And so, like, what could we do that was almost like borderline offensive? You're like, I would never want to look at type this big on a screen, but you know, maybe it works for their brand. I learned that showing physical limbs and anatomy on a device or on a screen actually makes it feel less like a web page, unless you're doing sort of a software as a service thing. But for them, you know, showing like, okay, this is how it might look on an iPad. Maybe this is a way that you recirculate, getting from article to article. We looked at recirculation modules and a way that you can kind of continue reading and tease the next thing. So we looked at a bunch of different stuff through this element collage without having to design full pages, full sites, without having to design the iPhone, iPad, desktop combo. This is a nice way of getting them to understand how it would work kind of from screen to screen. One of the things that I like about, and one of the things I love about doing projects in the open and writing about the stuff that we're doing is that other people get to read it and then use it and then tell you how to do it better. And you're like, well, I invented it. And people are like, no, here's a better way to do that. Clear Left is an agency in the UK. And they started using element collages in their design framework. And they wrote about it, too. So they posted this example of this site. And they said, this was an element collage that they did for a client. So they sent it to the client. And the client says, we love it, it looks great, like we're really happy with it. But what happens when you click on the icons that are there above the footer? And you can't really blame them for that, right? So this is not a web page, it's supposed to be like a diagram, but modern web pages kind of look like this nowadays, right? So you can't really blame them, you can't hold that against them for not knowing that. So what ClearLeft started to do on their next project is they started to do all their element collages horizontally. And that completely eliminated the, well, is this a web page or is this not a web page or whatever? And it's such an obvious thing. Like in hindsight, I'm like, oh yeah, duh, that makes total sense. But it just never would have occurred to me to do it that way until they said it. And they said they were finding a lot of success with this. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna do that for my next project. The next project I worked on was with Entertainment Weekly, and it was doing a mobile site for them. And my art director, Scott Cook, on this one, he did his whole element collage horizontally. And we never once came up with encountered the discussion of, is this a web page, or does this go on top of this, or can we move this up and down in the stack? It was literally a collection of elements. Now, this is not a style guide yet. This is something where we're just kind of exploring with different things. So as an example, if you look at the bottom left there, we've got multiple variations of the same element. So we could do some iterations in there and say, okay, of these six, which ones are working well for you? You know, if you look in the top right, same thing there. We're showing kind of captions on top of a photo. And we got into the same kind of discussions that you would want to have in an information architecture round or in a design round, where we talked about, okay, well, we can't obscure the photo because that gets into licensing rights and with photographers. And so we had the same discussions and the necessary discussions that we needed to. But we got through it in a different way. And we also eliminated a lot of the discussions of like, well, how does this look on a phone, or how does this look on an iPad? Because, you know, we could easily say to them, here's a couple of ingredients. You guys can take them and sort of push them around, like print them out and then cut them out on paper. And that's actually what we did in the kickoff. Print these out, cut them all up, and then assemble them and see how they look. And so that was a really effective technique for us as well. When I talked to Paul Lloyd, who was a designer at ClearLeft at the time and started using the element collages, he now works at The Guardian, or I think he may have just left there. He said, you know that time in Photoshop where you're just about to export something to send to a client, but right before you do it, you turn off a bunch of layers. You're like, okay, not this, not this, not this. He's like, well, element collages are kind of like giving your client a peek at all those layers. But it's kind of like, here's some things that I'm thinking about, here's some things that I'm not sure about, and you turn that into a discussion rather than, you know, I've made the comp, everything that is in here is final, you know, and we can iterate kind of in a small way on that. So you might be saying, or you might be thinking, yeah, this is all good, the element collage stuff, the inventory stuff, but why not just skip all that stuff and design in the browser? Like, why not? Yeah, Ben.
Right. I'm guessing that you're a little bit more selective than that on what you put into an element collage.
I'm not, actually.
You're not.
Okay. No, I think, so there's a great book called The Win Without Pitching Manifesto by Blair Enns. It's a great book. It's really short. If you haven't read it and if you do any sort of client service, it is fantastic. And the first chapter, it's written sort of like Mein Kampf style. Like, it is a manifesto. And the first chapter is, we will replace presentations with conversations. I think that to me has always stuck out. So I am not selective at all about what I show to clients. Like, here's the thing, and I think one of the things that I found valuable is actually, and this goes against all good design advice that you hear from everybody, right? Everybody says, don't show your client that thing that you threw away. Like, don't be like, see, here's how this doesn't work. And I've actually started to do that to see, like, because I heard that years ago, and I was like, no, I'm never gonna show them the thing that I threw out. And I've started to do that more and more, and it's worked out really well, where I think the piece that is missing from that is that I need to exude confidence as well, right? So I need to say, I threw this out because of all the great reasons that I threw this out for, and this is why you're trusting me to do this. And I found that actually builds more trust than it disengenders it. So I've actually been less and less selective about what I hide, and then more and more strong and confident about why I would have not chosen that thing. So I think it comes with it's certainly different from scenario to scenario, and some clients are like, no, actually, I really like that thing that you threw away, and I have to be open to that, right? So I think, you know, certainly things that I know for sure shouldn't make it in, I think maybe I will just kind of toss those out, but likely for me, that has been thrown out early in my design process. If I'm deciding between two things and I can't decide, sometimes I'm like, here's what I'm deciding between, what do you guys think? I think that working with clients is a collaboration, and if you're working with a client, you have to trust them to know their business. And if you don't, they're sort of disrespecting them in the same way that they would disrespect you by not trusting your design sense. So I try to respect that, and I try to think about, like, okay, I'll show them something, and they will likely have a better choice than I will because they know their business or their users maybe better than I do.
Yeah.
Yeah, great question. Anybody else? Cool. So what about this designing in the browser thing? Why not just skip all that element collage stuff and all the inventory stuff and just design in the browser? So I have a couple problems with designing in the browser, at least the way that I've seen it done. For me, sometimes when people say design in the browser, sometimes it means skipping design. Right? And I think there is a piece of design that is about decoration and assembly and layout that I think can happen in the browser and can happen easily. But I think there's another part of design that's that rendering intent part, where sometimes you skip it. Right? Sometimes you go straight to a build. And if you go straight to a build, you're not really intentionally doing anything. You're just constructing. I think constructing isn't the same thing as designing. So if you're talking about skipping the design part, if you can make the design part work in the browser, that's great. But oftentimes when I see things that were designed in the browser, it looks like it has skipped design. Like in the same way, like when people say designers should learn to code, absolutely. I'm a designer, I code, and I think that's a really great and valuable part of my skill set, because some things I can do in code, some things I can do in Photoshop, some things I can just kind of jump back and forth. But when that means, well, designers should just become developers, it's sort of the same thing as saying, well, just skip the design piece, skip the rendering of intent piece. I think that's problematic and actually dangerous to design work. And then I guess the last thing is that some sites that are designed in the browser just kind of look designed in the browser. Right? OK, tough crowd. OK. I don't think that that's anybody's fault. I think that it's not about designers or developers don't know how to design or anything like that. That is purely a fault of our tools. We do not have good tools for designing in the browser. Right? Consider for a minute the way that we typically work. Right? We write code in this. We pick our color schemes, and we write code and our color highlighting, syntax highlighting, and then we save and refresh, and we open the browser, we compile, and we get this like hopeful like jack in the box, like, whoa, nope, that's not actually it. And then we go back to our code, and we do the same thing, and we rinse and repeat. That is not a good way to design in the browser. Sure, the Chrome inspector or the Safari inspector sort of helps get a little bit closer to that, but even that is still miles off from the way that it could be. I'm going to show you a talk by a guy named Brett Victor, and he talks about how designing in the browser, I think, should actually work without actually talking about designing in the browser. Have a listen to what he says.
Creators need an immediate connection to what they're creating. So that's my principle. Creators need an immediate connection to what they create. And what I mean by that is, when you're making something, if you make a change or you make a decision, you need to see the effect of that immediately. There can't be any delay, and there can't be anything hidden. Creators have to be able to see what they're doing. So now I'm going to show you a series of cases where I noticed that principle is violated, and I'll show you what I did about that. And then I'm going to talk about the larger context in which I do this work. So to begin with, let's think about coding. Here's how coding works. You type a bunch of code into a text editor, kind of imagining in your head what each line of code is going to do. And then you compile and run, and something comes out. So in this case, it's just JavaScript drawing to a canvas, and it draws this little scene with a tree. But if there's anything wrong with the scene, or if I want to make changes, if I have further ideas, I have to go back to the code. And I edit the code, compile and run, see what it looks like. Anything wrong, I go back to the code. Most of my time is spent working in the code, working in a text editor blindly, without an immediate connection to this thing, which is what I'm actually trying to make. So I feel this goes against this principle I have, that creators need an immediate connection to what they're making. So I tried to come up with a coding environment that I thought might be more in line with this principle I have. So what I have here is I've got this picture on this side and the code on this side. And now this part draws the sky, and this draws the mountains, and this draws the tree. And when I make any change to the code, the picture changes immediately. So the code and the picture are always in sync. There's no compile and run. I just change things in the code, and I see things change in the picture. And now that we have this immediate connection between the code and the picture, we can start thinking about ways of changing the code other than typing. So for example, this number here is the length of the branches. If I want to control that number, I just point my mouse to it, hold down the control key, and I can dial it up and down. So I can see what it looks like for big branches or small branches, and I can kind of converge on what feels right to me artistically. And this works for any number of the code. I just point to it, dial it up and down. And some of these numbers here, I know what they do, but it's still kind of surprising to see them do it. And other ones are just completely surprising. So down here, I've got this for loop where I'm counting to 16. I'm putting 16 little pink blossoms on every branch. And I can turn that down for less blossom or turn it up for more. But look at what I'm doing here. I'm just kind of moving that number up and down around 20 or so. And it has this really interesting shimmering effect. It kind of looks like the wind is blowing through the tree. And the first time I saw this, I immediately started thinking about how I could use this effect for an animation. How would I ever have discovered that if I had to compile and run between every change? So much of art, so much of creation is discovery, and you can't discover anything if you can't see what you're doing.
Did you catch that? How would I ever have discovered that animation idea if I had to compile every time I made a change? So much of creation is about discovery, and you can't discover anything if you can't see what you're doing. So for me, when I think about designing in the browser, I think about it a little bit differently. I think about it as deciding in the browser instead of designing in the browser. Right? If you think about it as binary, either you use Photoshop or Sketch or you use the browser, that's a little too sort of hard-lined. I think, you know, a lot of us think about like Photoshop as the place where decisions are made, and then the browser is the part where those decisions are implemented. But instead, if you think about it as like a continuum, you know, maybe Photoshop is where some ideas can be started, and the browser is where those ideas can be finessed, or vice versa. Maybe the browser is where you start some ideas, you bring it back into Photoshop, finesse it, and move it back. There's kind of this nice back and forth. If you haven't seen that talk before, it is a fantastic talk. It's probably one of the best talks I've ever seen. It's called Inventing on Principle by Brett Victor. It's just really wonderful. He shares more examples like that where he's kind of taken that to the next level and kind of escalated that theory or the principles that he has. Another form of sketching for me is prototyping. And I think this gets a little bit closer to what designing in the browser should actually look like. I think it's possible to design in the browser. I think our tools aren't there yet, so I think we need to hack it a little bit. But I think that maybe look a little bit different than what we imagine it to be. So I'll show you what I think it could look like and would love your thoughts on it. I did this project last year for a company you guys probably never heard of. And I did it with my friend Jamie. And Jamie is awesome. I've worked with him for a long time. I love working with Jamie because I think that he's a designer, but he doesn't know how to use Photoshop or Illustrator or anything like that. He knows how to write code. So his design is in code. But he is as much of a designer as I think I am. Like I think we do the same thing. So Jamie has these principles, these guidelines for prototyping. I mean, he prototypes everything. That's the way that he approaches code. So here are his guidelines for prototyping. The first guideline, each prototype must take less than 1 hour to make. If you're spending more than 1 hour on a prototype, you are not prototyping, you are building something. Right, so every prototype has to be 1 hour or less. The second is that the first prototype should be something that anybody can build. We'll come back to this one, because I'll show you how that comes into play. And the last guideline is build ugly. So let me show you what build ugly means. This is a site that was built a couple of years ago. This is built by an agency called Big Spaceship. That's where I worked a couple of years ago, and this is a little bit before I got there. On the right, there's a site for Corona Beach. And on the site, you could like play calming music, and you could play games. On the right is a comp, right? So that's what it actually would look like. On the left is a fully functioning prototype of what's on the right. So you'll see there that previous and next arrows work. It'll jump you to the next track. This thing plays music. The play button is that rectangle at the top, right? Doesn't even look close to the play button. And then in the middle is where the text would go, right? Where it says like audio control, like that's where text go. Now, how many people have used Flash before? Anybody do Flash work? Okay, so for those of you that know Flash, you know about this. For those of you that don't, I'll explain a little bit. In Flash, you can draw a text box anywhere and you can type text in that text box. Now, the text box will automatically resize to the text that fits in it unless you specifically say, don't do that. So if you look at that word idle, I-D-L, and then the E wraps to the next line, that is specifically designed. That, like, to do that is actually very difficult to do in Flash, and that is specifically designed. Now, the reason for designing it that way is that you cannot launch that. Right? You can't launch the version on the left. You can't be like, and so how many times do we do this, where we build things and we're like, okay, it's good enough, I'll come back and I'll add the polish later. Like, and then you never come back and you add the polish, right? You're like, yeah, it's good enough. If you build ugly, it's not good enough. You have to go back to it and apply the graphics and apply the text treatments and apply the button styles. And like you can't say, well, yeah, that's good enough. But that's fully functioning. Everything there is working, and all of the polish needs to be applied. So building ugly is really important because it forces you to come back to what you're doing to apply that level of polish. You cannot launch that. Here's another example. Fully functioning prototype on the left, comp on the right. Probably my favorite example. Comp on the right, fully functioning working prototype on the left. Like that was actually a car. You would see the car drive. I don't know exactly how. And you would see like all the glass panes were like these gray lines. It was crazy. So when Jamie and I were brainstorming for this project, the creative direction for the site that we came up with was, let's let the user see the product from all angles. Right? That was like sort of the tagline, the motto for the project. And we didn't talk about how, and we don't talk about anything. But that was the brief. So I went off and I did a sketch, and this was my sketch. And I wrote the copy, and I grabbed some images from the internet, and I made some colors. But this is like, you know, this is basically my prototype. Like, I don't know if the copy's right, I don't know if this button's right, I don't know if it's the right screen, but this is kind of the way that I was thinking about it. And this was Jamie's sketch. Now remember the second guideline of prototyping. Your first prototype must be something that anyone can make. So this was a div, it was lime green, had a width and a height. That's it, prototype number one. This is prototype number two. He's playing with some CSS transforms and seeing if he could skew that thing. And this is prototype number three. This is prototype number four. And then he started to move out of this environment. This is just a blank web page. And he started to do things in CodePen. And then he started to animate these things. So what would it look like spinning? And at this point is when I start to see what he's thinking about, see the product from every angle. He's thinking literally you could like turn this whole thing around and it's spinning and you could literally see the physical aspects of it from every angle. Now if you think about the progression of these prototypes, the reason that he prototypes this way is that anytime somebody new joins the project, they don't have to catch up with this. They could just look at every prototype, 001, 002, 003, 004, 005, and watch how a div turns into a skewed div, turns into a cube, turns into something 3D, starts to spin in 3D space, starts to do the next thing. You can track his progress. Now, this is like a level up from GitHub. This is not like go and view revision history, because that's still very difficult. He tracks each of these things so that you can look at every single prototype and look at them in your Finder, look at them in your browser, look at them via URL, and see where he's going with this. The next prototype, if you look at that HTML box, you know, what would happen if we took all that stuff out of HTML and we generated all of it with JavaScript? How does that change performance? How does that change the animation? How does that change anything about this? And so he shares with me these six or seven prototypes that he's got here. And I'm like, OK, I see what you're doing now. I see how you're going about this. So this is my next sketch. Right? And my next sketch was, OK, well, maybe if I take something that you're used to seeing, maybe I can let you see a different side of it. Maybe it's just an angle. Maybe it's things extruded. But basically, what we're doing now is we're riffing off of each other. Right? We're not waterfall at all. It's not like I design all of the things, and then he'll go and build those things. It's that he's designing, and I'm designing, and we're riffing off each other. His design is just in codes and in words, and mine is in binary, essentially. So how do we riff off of each other, which is something that doesn't happen often on web projects. Right? It's like information architect creates the architecture, that gets passed along to designer who implements that architecture and design, that gets passed along to developer who implements the design and information architecture in the build. And there's no back and forth. There's no place where your crazy, smart, talented engineers could influence the architecture of the site, because it's too late. It's too late when it gets to that point. And then the developer becomes the person that is the gatekeeper or becomes the person that can say yes or no to things and just implement things. It's too late for ideas. So in this framework, now we're kind of flipping that on its head, where everybody's able to riff off what the other person is doing. So I did this sketch now. And Jamie's like, OK, I see what you're doing with that sketch. So now he starts to do this. This is his next prototype. And this is a really special point in this project, because he started to do something really special at the bottom. He started to write these problem and solution statements. Right? And he wrote here, initial test, scale the browser. Try scaling vertically and horizontally. And for every prototype that he's making, he's trying to do one thing. He's trying to solve one problem. So the problem that he was trying to solve in that one was, what happens when this resizes, because it's going to be a responsive site? I want to figure that out. Then the next problem he tried to solve, well, what happens if we put an animated GIF in there? Does that change anything? Does that change performance? Does that change the way that we make this? How well does that work? What if we make that clickable? Does that change anything? Like, what can I test there? What if we use the 3JS library and we combine that with a custom CSS a custom CSS 3D primitive? What happens if we texture the thing, you know, instead? Like, what if we use just sort of a Chrome texture? What happens if we drop in some trackball controls and we start to drag that thing around? Right? And each of these prototypes are just designed to solve one thing. What happens if we play with the depth? Oh, we get this really weird result if we do that. And we get this sort of like lunch tray looking thing. You know, what if we make it gummy? Ooh, like, we don't know if we're going to make it gummy, but what happens if we do that? Does that inspire some ideas? What if we made it sway a little bit? Sway a little bit. Sway a little bit. Sway. What if we texture it using the textures in my actual comp? What happens there? Like, what if we make the rollover extensions in 3D? Maybe we can bring those out in 3D space. This is another special moment in this prototyping process, because by this point, Jamie's probably done 50 or 60 prototypes. And now, he's combining the 3D extensions with Sway. And so he has these 60 things that he's solved individually, and now he's starting to put them together. What happens if we combine prototype number 6 with prototype number 17? What happens if we combine number 30 with number 45? And then you can do more and more of that. What if you combine 2 together, and then 3 together, and then 6, and then 10, and then 15, and then 20, and then 30, and then 50? What if you combine all the prototypes together? Then technically what you've done is you've just built the site. Right, you solved all the problems individually, and then as you put them together, you can see what problems they create together. You can start to solve those. And as you assemble more and more of those things, you actually build the site. And you've solved, because you've solved all those problems. So we'll talk about that in just a minute. But before we move on, let's take a step back and look at tools and outputs that we're talking about. Sure, keep using Sketch, keep using Illustrator, keep using Photoshop. But what if you use them to make prototypes? What if you use them to make element collages? What if you start to use typecast and HTML5 and CodePen and all these tools as designers? How does that change the way that you approach your work? The last step, if you haven't guessed it already, is that designers need to assemble. Right? And that's the easy part. That should be the easy part of this whole process, of this whole framework. Right? That's all Jamie was doing. Once he had the prototypes, once he had the sketches, you just combine your sketches. That's the easy part. There's this concept in cooking called mise en place, which basically translates to everything in its place. And if you ask any professional chef, they don't chop their ingredients, they don't assemble their ingredients while they're cooking something. They're not like, oh, I want to cook some chicken. I'll put some chicken in a pan and saute it, and then I'll go and chop the onions. By that time, it's too late. You've burnt your chicken. Like, you prep first. You prep before service. You get all your ingredients in the same place. You get your cheese. You chop up your corn. You chop up your onions. You grate. You juice. You do whatever you need to do before you need to cook. And then when you cook, it's easy. 15 minutes to make a dish. You got all your ingredients. You can cook a chicken in 15 minutes. No big deal. And we don't approach web design that way. We spend all of our time assembling, which is why it's so difficult. Right? We try to figure out everything that we should have sketched out or planned or inventory while we assemble. It's like trying to cook your chicken and chop the onions at the same time. Your time management runs out. Like it doesn't work out that way. This should be the easy part because you should have done all the hard work before. So how do you do that? What kind of tools do you use to do that? Well, in the latest Creative Cloud release, Photoshop just released a thing called libraries. And so this is a GIF of me assembling a site for Radio Free Europe. I had done all the hard work of inventorying. We inventoried all the patterns with them, all of the different elements that we needed. And then we just started to assemble them. I put them all in the library thing. And then they were like, OK, we need a comp of the article page. I'm like, cool. I need a comment thread. I need a large story. I need small stories. I need the footer. I need the header. Literally 30 seconds to make a comp. Like, that's not hyperbole. 30 seconds. Because I've spent hours before that assembling and designing the right pieces. And then when I need to make the comp, okay, I just drag this in, drag this in, drag this in, drag this in, I'm good, next. Another one, another one, another one. Like, so I have mobile and desktop and iPad and whatever, you know, whatever we needed to be able to make, it's easy enough to make. If you prefer the code version of that, there are tools like Pattern Lab out there. Pattern Lab, if you haven't heard about it, it is a methodology that lets you kind of break down pieces of a site into their smallest units, which Brad, who created this, calls atoms, and then as you combine atoms, they turn into molecules. And if you combine molecules, they turn into organisms, and then templates and pages. When I did the work with Radio Free Europe, we did all this work in a spreadsheet. The first 2 weeks of the project was, let's just write down all of the atoms that we're going to need, we'll write down all of the molecules that we're going to need, and we'll write down all of the organisms that we're going to need. And we had discussions in these Google Docs, like, is this a molecule, or is this an organism, or, you know, do we really need this one? Is this one the same thing as that thing? We did all of the work in here, And designing it took maybe like 4 or 5 days. Like designing the whole thing, designing the whole site took 4 or 5 days because we spent 2 or 3 weeks on this. It's really, we did all the hard work here, right? And this is something that we knew that their team was familiar with. So we had all the dialogue about it in this format. And then the assembly part was just really easy. So when you look at that, when you look at assembling, you can use tools like Creative Cloud or Pattern Lab or all sorts of tools out there. There are some great tools for assembling this stuff as long as you've done the hard work prior. So let's look at this kind of before and after. Before, designer's job was just to do comps. Now, maybe your job is to do all of these things. Maybe you should make prototypes. Maybe you should be doing more performance budgets or inventorying more. Maybe you should be sketching in different ways. Maybe you should be doing those things. From a tool standpoint, you know, sure, using things like that, continue to use those, continue to get better at that. But what happens if on your next project your go-to tool is Sublime Text, or your go-to tool is CodePen, or your go-to tool is an Excel spreadsheet? Like, what if that's the hero tool of the project? So now you might be looking at this and you might be saying, like, well, wait, are you trying to turn me into a little bit information architect, a little bit content strategist, a little bit of everybody? Yes, sort of. I think it's maybe the best way I can describe it is this. Michael Jackson didn't play any instruments, but he understood them intrinsically. He was actually considered one of the best musicians of all time, but he didn't really play any instruments. Here's a clip of him writing the song Beat It. So this is before it's released, before it's recorded or produced or anything. Take a listen.
Okay, this is the harmonies, and the vocal harmonies on the choruses of Beat It. I'll do the verses, then I'll do the choruses. 1, 2, 3, 4.
Beat it. Beat it.
Beat it.
Amazing. He overdubs. He sings a lead vocal. He overdubs the bass. He sings the backing vocals. He sings the minor percussion. He sings all of that. Now, he's not a musician, but he understood all of those instruments intrinsically. He knows what the bass needs to do. He knows what the background singers need to do. He knows what the minor percussion needs to do. He knows all of those things. Now, that's not perfect. It was a sketch, right? That's an equivalent of a sketch of a song. He goes flat when he goes to the tonic. He's Michael Jackson, and he went flat. But it doesn't matter at that point. Like, he's trying to sketch something out for everybody. And what he's really demonstrating there is he's demonstrating empathy. He's demonstrating that he knows what everybody needs to do, and he's able to direct it because he understands it so well. It's not like, oh, I'll just tell the bass player what to do. Or it's also not like, well, the bass player can just do whatever he wants because that's not my domain of expertise. That's part of what made Michael Jackson such a great musician, is that he understood all of those things. And so as a designer, you need to understand all those things. You need to understand code and information architecture and prototyping and all that stuff. It's not a reinvention of the designer role. I think it is a natural evolution. I think that's where design is going. I think that's where designers need to be and need to be doing. I'm not asking you to reinvent yourselves. I think that we live in a different world now, though, than a couple years ago when we could design flat comps for 960-pixel websites. Like, people access the internet from devices that fit in the palm of their hands and their pockets, all the way to giant billboards and everything in between. I showed you a clip of Stephanie before. She didn't reinvent herself, she evolved. You might not know her as Stephanie Germanotta anymore, but you probably know her as one of the best-selling artists of all time. She's Lady Gaga. She used the same tools, vocals, musical ability to expand her output. So my challenge to you, expand your tools, expand your output. Now you know what to make. Thanks.
Thanks for watching the Build Right Maker Series. Check out our other videos from industry leaders at buildright.io. Or, even better, buy a ticket and attend in person.